Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sustainability Leadership, a Swedish approach to transforming your company, your industry, and the world, by Henrik Henriksson and Elaine Weidman Grunewald. Foreword by Johan Rockström. Narrated by Chris Sorensen. Publisher's Note: This audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Foreword. This is written in the beginning of April 2020. The world is fighting the coronavirus pandemic, and the outcome is still very uncertain. The world economy is shaking, the number of confirmed deaths has just passed 80,000, and the mortality curve is still pointing upward, while the big fear is to what degree COVID-19 hits countries in the developing world. In this turbulent time, science, politics, business, and civil society need to work together to handle both short and long-term challenges in a collaborative fashion. It is already clear that there is so much to learn from the coronavirus crisis. One lesson is the need to build resilience in a world that is, and will continue to be, characterized by turbulence, surprise, and shocks from social, economic, and ecological changes that moreover form part of a connected web of interactions in a big world on a small planet. Businesses around the world face a new reality, and it is a deeper reality than the pandemic alone. I am not talking here about globalization or the digital revolution of exponential change in technology and innovation, nor is it about social instabilities and rising inequities. The global health crisis is a manifestation of something bigger. It is a manifestation of the fact that we, the modern world of today, now constitute the dominant force of change of the entire planet. Driven by globalization, dense population pressures, and unsustainable production and consumption, and causing impacts on health, conflict, insecurity, and development, the fact that we are now in the Anthropocene, the new geological epoch triggered by our unsustainable exploitation of nature and climate, is the mother of all challenges. And it changes everything. We have had zoonotic disease outbreaks, when infectious diseases are passed from animals to humans in the history of mankind. Think Spanish flu after World War I. But the frequency is on the increase, and both the source and impacts can be attributed to human pressures in the Anthropocene. The coronavirus crisis, however devastating in terms of human loss, is an alarm bell for us, signaling that our recovery must be a transformation to a resilient future where people and planetary health go hand in hand. Scientifically, we can now say with a high degree of certainty that we have changed the living conditions on Earth as they have been since we left the last ice age 12,000 years ago. We are following a path, if we continue burning fossil fuels and degrading nature as we do today, that will take us to global warming exceeding 3 degrees Celsius in only 80 years, when your children have grown-up children. In a geological blink of time, we are at risk of pushing our home, Earth, back to a climactic point she has not been in for the past 4 million years. Our only chance to meet the Paris Climate Agreement of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius, or at least stay well below 2 degrees Celsius, is to bend the curve of global emissions within the next few years, and then cut emissions by half each decade, until we reach a largely fossil fuel-free world economy by mid-century in 30 years. This is what we scientifically call the carbon law, as it must trigger the same level of exponential innovation as Moore's law, which, in 1965, predicted an exponential innovation pace of doubling the speed in computer transistors every 18 to 24 months. This led to a self-fulfilling prophecy driving the innovation that we have seen in the digital industry through the present day. But this will not be enough. Stabilizing the global climate at a level that will not generate unmanageable risks will also require that we halt the destruction of nature. Today, we have reached the sixth mass extinction of species on Earth, the first to be caused by another species, ourselves. We have wiped out 60% of animal population since the 1970s and are on track to lose 1 million out of 8 million known species on Earth. The overall conclusion is that we have reached a state of planetary emergency. We have rising evidence that global warming, deforestation, and loss of ecosystems increase the risk of zoonotic disease outbreaks, which can transform into pandemics in the globalized world of the 21st century. We now need to mobilize all human ingenuity, leadership, and action for our common future on Earth. What we do over the coming decade is likely to determine the future for all coming generations in the world. Business plays a fundamental role in this context, as a major source of unsustainable pressures on the planet, from use of natural resources to ecosystem change and greenhouse gas emissions. Yet the private sector also represents the ability to provide solutions and be a leader in climate action. We are starting to see examples of that leadership today, which we direly need to see scaled and accelerated. My personal conclusion is that business, across a wide range of sectors from food to energy and transport, injected pivotal support that provided the political leadership a significant portion of the confidence and courage to take the Paris climate negotiations in 2015 all the way to a successful global accord. Business has continued to play a very important and constructive role on climate action. Immediately after Paris, hundreds of international businesses stepped up to adopt science-based targets, SBTs for climate action, first to meet the 2 degrees Celsius target and increasingly to reach 1.5 degrees Celsius. Right now, business is rallying to move from climate to planetary boundaries by engaging in the science-based targets, SBTs for Earth Initiative under the Global Commons Alliance, initiated by the Global Environment Facility, GEF, together with science, future Earth, and business. We mean business. All this is really important. Even more fundamental, though, is the narrative framing of this action. The fact that climate action is increasingly moving from an environmental agenda to becoming a part of core business. Here, Henrik Henriksson, as CEO of Scania, and Elaine Weidman Grunewald, sustainability leader and innovator with long experience in the technology business, represent 2 global leaders. When they argue for making sustainability core to the business, they do it with empirical evidence and profound conviction in a way that few leaders can. And it is here that they provide a really important piece of strategic advice for all business leaders, applicable to all sectors. Making sustainability the core of your business is not a moral agenda. It is the pathway to profits and business success. As they point out, purpose-driven leadership is the most important business asset as it generates innovation and gives a competitive edge. Together, Henrik and Elaine provide what I consider the most important business advice one can get today: to embed the core business in a culture of sustainability. They do so by representing 2 of the most important sectors in the transformation to sustainable development, namely decarbonizing the transport sector and making digitalization work for sustainability. This makes the voice of these two business leaders so valuable and timely at a juncture where we must accelerate and scale innovations and solutions toward a prosperous and equitable future for humanity within planetary boundaries. Potsdam Institute of Climate Impact Research, University of Potsdam, Potsdam, Germany. Johann Rockström. Preface. Many people have asked us how we came to write this book together. One rainy Swedish afternoon in early spring 2019, Elaine and Kershini Henriksson, Henrik's wife, were sitting down for that quintessential Swedish ritual, the fika, a coffee and cake break that is more of a state of mind than a time of day. Elaine had recently left her position leading the sustainability work at information and communication technology, ICT company Ericsson, and was embarking on the next chapter in her journey. The discussion turned to climate change and why it was a game-changing moment for companies to step up on sustainability. You know, Kershini mused, thinking of family chats around her own dinner table. Henrik shares our passion for sustainability. He really burns for it just as much as you and is frustrated over the lack of action. You two should write a book. Kershini's idea resonated with both of us. Like a core theme described in this book, we were unconventional partners with distinctly different backgrounds. Yet we share two fundamental beliefs. One, that the world faces unprecedented and urgent global challenges and that business needs to step up. And, two, that while not perfect, Sweden is brimming with great examples of how companies are working profitably and meaningfully to move the needle on sustainability. So we've opened up our toolbox and shared our experience, along with that of other leaders who share our passion for sustainability leadership. The Swedish companies and business leaders we interviewed in the book represent a broad spectrum, from startups to large industrial giants with 100-year-plus histories. We wrote this book to use our own platforms and, in our own way, help to accelerate that momentum and catalyze change. The question business leaders face is not just why to act, but how. How to best engage others on the same journey, and how every leader can maximize his or her impact. Over the course of our careers, we have figured out some of the answers to those questions. That led us to spend many hours creating and discussing a leadership model with sustainability at its core and a formula for that all-important how. Since we began writing this book, we've been encouraged by the progress we've seen and the commitments that are being made by business leaders all over the world. The tides seem to be shifting toward greater recognition of the importance of sustainability. It is no longer a race to the bottom, but rather a race to the top. The desire to write this book also comes from a very personal place for both of us. Anyone who has ever worked with Elaine knows that she is nothing if not persistent, for the things that she believes in and is passionate about, and how she is driven to see results. She has worked for small nonprofits and large multinationals, but what most inspires her is the private sector's powerful platform for positive sustainability impact. Her work has taken her from the corridors of the United Nations to refugee settlements in South Sudan, visiting the poorest, seemingly forgotten parts of the world, often without hope, but where the strongest hope often emerges. Whether you're in the developed world with the most advanced technology or in the developing world with access to only the most basic technology, the capacity of the private sector and the power of an individual leader to wield influence is bottomless if the will or ambition is there. Elaine is all about building coalitions of the willing, Those who, like her, embrace the yes and, not the no but, way of getting things done. She sums it up this way. Greater collaborations, partnerships, sharing of ideas. That's what we need to achieve the exponential impact that can move the needle on so many sustainable development challenges. Adopting the UN Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, was a powerful moment of coming together. But without greater engagement of the private sector, without that exponential impact, there will be no future to sustain. This book has also been about creating a vision for the next generation of the coalition of the willing, the ones that want to go for something greater than business as usual. For Henrik, the why of his journey in sustainability leadership is crystallized in an actual place, his summer cottage on the island of Blidö in the Stockholm archipelago. That is our sanctuary. That is where my wife and I have raised our two daughters. Now 9 and 11 years old, the place in the archipelago, close to the nature, the fresh air, and the clear water, has been the place that has started to shape them as global citizens, shape their values and their beliefs. It is that sanctuary that I want to save and protect today for the future generations. And it's there that I think about the legacy I would like to leave for them one day. Henrik continues, I've always felt that at the end of the day, the true judge of my legacy are my daughters. I have this picture in my head when I'm retired and sitting on my favorite bench on Blidö at age 70, and my two grown-up daughters come to sit with me. Two scenarios unfold. In the first, they ask, weren't you the CEO of that company called Scania? Didn't you see what was going on? Why didn't you take your responsibility? Were you blind or stupid? In the second scenario, they ask, how did you find the strength, the courage, and the drive to transform not only that company, but a small piece of the world? And of course, I want it to be the second scenario. This book is an opportunity to tell the story, not about me, but about all the great people in my company and how they build a better world. The Scania family. We are great, but our journey has just begun, and we can do better. With this book, we want to encourage you and others to start your journey. Use your ambition and drive to create your legacy. This is a perfect time to start. Stockholm, Sweden, Henrik Henriksson, Elaine Weidman Grunewald. Chapter 1. Introduction. The Case for Action. Exponentiality Cheat Sheet. We're just a few months into a new and pivotal decade, and the global coronavirus pandemic has changed life as we know it. Turning a crisis into an opportunity is, of course, a cliché, and before the coronavirus, we were already on the brink of another, slower sustainability disaster, climate change. Somehow, it is easier to mobilize resources to solve the critical, short-term, immediate problems as opposed to the climate crisis, which has been underway for decades. The pandemic has created an unprecedented, terrible reality that will change us in ways we can't even anticipate. But it's also a wake-up call and a chance to rethink how we conduct business. It has presented a tabula rasa, a clean slate, an opportunity to restart business based on sustainable principles. Business cannot thrive on economic returns alone. As we lay out in this book, we need to measure success beyond profit to motivate change. And just as health workers, fire departments, police forces, and many others have been on the front lines of the COVID-19 pandemic, it's time for business leaders to step up to the front lines of the sustainability crisis. COVID-19 has created a lot of fear and uncertainty. But this means that it is a leadership imperative. In reaction to the pandemic, companies can demonstrate in unprecedented ways their commitment to purpose and society. The businesses that are authentic will build trust, loyalty, and resilience. The pandemic also highlights the importance of science and facts, a point we underscore in this book. In this case, COVID-19 has shown us that human health and the health of the planet are inseparable, that we must resist fake news and convenient truths, and that partnerships are key to solving major challenges. Now more than ever, concerted global action for a more sustainable world is urgently needed. While we grapple with the seismic shifts in our society and economy brought on by the pandemic, the full consequences of which we can't yet predict, we cannot lose focus on the myriad challenges that the planet and humanity are facing. Climate change, rising inequality, and unsustainable resource use continue to demand our attention and action. This is not a head-in-the-sand moment. It is an invitation for the world to change direction, faster and more decisively than ever. It is also an opportunity for the private sector to exercise much-needed leadership in finding solutions rather than adding to the problems. With just 10 years left to achieve the UN Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, agreed by the world's nations in 2015, all sectors of society need to mobilize for a decade of action. Courageous and visionary business leaders are already heeding that call, inspiring others to set big, bold goals. There has also been a remarkable shift among investors, including influential mainstream investors, toward prioritizing sustainability and factoring the impact of climate change into investment decisions. Citizens around the world have been raising their voice for change in ever larger numbers. Business leaders can no longer turn away. This book is a wake-up call because there is simply no time to lose. Sweden may be a small country, but it has long punched above its weight. It is admired around the world for its progressive actions on sustainability, both as a nation and within the business sector. In this book, we share some of the essential ingredients in Sweden's secret sauce for corporate sustainability leadership. We draw extensively on our own leadership platforms and experience, as well as that of other business leaders who share the same commitment to sustainability. There is no business as usual in a turbulent world. Concerted global action for a more sustainable world is urgently needed, and the challenges we face are more complex than ever. While it is encouraging to see that setting sustainability targets has become business as usual for many companies, most targets are still based on achieving incremental improvements. Leaving a better world for our children requires not just some action from the business world, but exponential solutions. Sustainability is not a trend. It is a condition for future business success, and we need to up the game. It's important to keep in mind that sustainability is not philanthropy. It is much broader than environmental impact, corporate citizenship, or corporate social responsibility. It is not a standalone issue, but affects every aspect of a company, and therefore must be connected to the core business and aligned with overall corporate strategy. We define sustainability in the business context as an integrated approach to minimize a company's negative impacts and maximize its positive social, environmental, and economic impacts while creating long-term value for all stakeholders. We see sustainability as critical to the success of today's companies. Over the next 30 years, the world population will likely reach 10 billion people, all wanting the same opportunities for a decent life. Despite global economic gains, more than 700 million people, some 10% of the world's population, still live in extreme poverty. At least 2 billion people worldwide live in areas affected by fragility, conflict, and violence, where the intersection of poverty, high population growth, environmental degradation, natural hazards, and protracted conflict leaves them especially vulnerable. Unprecedented mass migration and movements of people have led to some 150 million people being displaced, equivalent to the world's 10th largest country, due to conflict and humanitarian crises. The current geopolitical instability, economic turbulence, protectionism, and polarization exacerbate global inequality and threaten peace and prosperity. While globalization has opened up new markets, it has also contributed to supply chain complexity and risks of labor exploitation. People and planet depend on one another, but this mutual dependency is not reflected in current measurements of economic growth. Gross domestic product, GDP, is an increasingly inadequate indicator of growth, productivity, and value from the perspective of sustainable development, and the relentless pursuit of higher GDP has resulted in environmental destruction and a narrow notion of human well-being netted at the expense of a fair and inclusive society. The UN Sustainable Development Goals, the world's plan to build a better world for people and the planet by 2030, call for a recalibration with only a decade left to shift direction. As many Swedish business leaders in this book point out, they are well aware of the privilege of birthright, coming from a country where basic needs are met and where they can rely on the benefits of social democracy, the right to free education, health care, and other aspects of a stable, well-functioning society. Part of their passion for creating purpose-driven companies stems from a recognition of the importance of balance. The drive for profitability is tempered with a sense of responsibility to create positive impact in the world and leave a worthy legacy, with sustainability as a central defining aspect. As CEO of Scania, Henrik knows that transport is a big part of the problem, responsible for 24% of direct CO2 emissions from fuel combustion, according to the International Energy Agency, and road vehicles account for nearly three-quarters of transport CO2 emissions. But he is also convinced that Scania can be part of the solution by driving the shift to fossil-free commercial transport. This book is partly the story of that journey. For her part, Elaine's years of experience with technology and digitalization have brought her to the same point of deep commitment to act, to realize the substantial sustainability benefits information and communication technology, ICT, can deliver, but also to raise awareness around and preempt its emerging challenges. Our case for action is for business leaders, the primary audience for this book. Business has more influence and power than ever before. In the past 20 years, the number of companies with a market capitalization above $100 billion has more than doubled from 37 in 1999 to 98 companies in 2019, and many companies today are larger than governments. CEOs and other executives are expected to step up and do their share to contribute to sustainability. While we are seeing the welcome appearance of individual CEO activists, this needs to become the norm, not the exception. Encouragingly, the financial world is waking up to the climate crisis and the costs of sustainability in action. The financial risks of climate change are now firmly on the agenda of many banks, insurers, and other financial institutions, and growing numbers are putting a stop to investment in the fossil fuel economy. In 2019, the European Investment Bank announced it would cease funding fossil fuel projects by the end of 2021. Sustainable investing and environmental social governance, ESG investing, is no longer niche, but rather one of the signature financial shifts of the past decade, obliging more companies to focus on sustainability as well as profits. The urgency to act is there. To be a leading company and business leader today requires sustainability leadership. But what does it take? Do you have the ambition and the tools to take your organization on the journey and make a credible, meaningful contribution to the sustainable development challenges the world faces? What can you learn from how Sweden is rising to the challenge? The Sustainability Leadership Model. This book attempts to answer some of those questions and point you in the right direction. It starts and ends with emphasizing the importance of leadership. Based on our combined decades of experience in moving the needle in our respective industries, we've developed a simple but powerful sustainability leadership model. That is, the journey to sustainable exponentiality with a Swedish flair. Figure 1.1. The three steps of the model consist of the following elements. The foundation. Discover your purpose, know your footprint, and build trust through responsible business. The core. Embed sustainability in your core business. Make it real by linking it to sales and customer value creation. The leap. Find your X factor. Adopt a societal and planetary lens, seek unconventional partnerships, and hone your influencing platform. The entire model is a journey towards sustainable exponential impact, or exponentiality, which is the destination. A simple formula shows how individual leaders can reach that destination and find their X factor. Think about the X factor as your level of ambition on steroids. What differentiates you as a sustainability superhero? Your ambition as a leader will be fundamental to guide the necessary actions to steer your company to sustainability leadership and market success. Through sharing the experiences of some of today's sustainability pioneers, our goal is to nudge business leaders to find their own X factor and start their exponentiality journey today. Engineers and mathematicians, take note. This is not meant to be a precise mathematical formula. It's rather about directional leadership. Figure 1.2. A listener's guide. We recognize listeners will be at different stages of the sustainability leadership journey. Some will be just setting out, and others may be well on the way to becoming exponential in their reach and ambition. Our intention is to provide guidance for business leaders at every stage. By business leader, we mean first and foremost CEOs, but also the C-suite, other senior executives, such as chief sustainability officers, or anyone trying to lead a sustainability transformation in the company. The book is structured to allow listeners to begin where they like, to sample the smörgåsbord, that famed Swedish buffet meal, according to their own preferences and appetite. The book is divided into three parts in line with the sustainability leadership model. Part 1.0, The Foundation, includes three chapters. Purpose-driven leadership, describing how a leader can discover their purpose or North Star to guide their sustainability leadership journey. Chapter 3. A stake in the ground, knowing the basics and outlining how to use stakeholder insights to help set your level of commitment or ambition. Chapter 4. And How to earn trust, underlining the importance of responsible business practices in building trust, a vital ingredient for successful partnerships and stakeholder relationships. Chapter 5. In Part 2.0, The Core, the focus is on business integration for sustainable value creation. The three chapters in this section include embedding sustainability in the core business, analyzing the strategy, business model, and value proposition to identify the challenges and opportunities that matter most and where you can have the greatest impact. Chapter 6. It all comes down to sales, making the all-important link between sustainability commitment and your customer. Chapter 7. And measuring impact beyond profit, how to use robust sustainability metrics to measure what matters and support your progress. Chapter 8. Part 3.0, The Leap, is where business leaders define their level of ambition. These five final chapters are intended to help leaders aim higher and set their sights on changing the world. It is here that the exponentiality formula can help visualize where the greatest transformational business potential lies. The path to potentiality introduces the societal ecosystem approach and how using societal and planetary lenses helps you understand your impact on society. Chapter 9. Society as a stakeholder applies the exponentiality formula and helps you to find your X factor, in part through unconventional partnerships. Chapter 10. Making business sense of the SDGs is about understanding how you fit into the broader sustainable development agenda and how to make the UN Sustainable Development Goals purpose fit for business and be on the alert for SDG washing. Chapter 11. The next sustainability frontier is digital, explores how digitalization is a powerful accelerator, but why caution is needed to avoid some of the inherent risks in data-driven societies, that is, data pollution. Chapter 12. Find Your Personal Influencing Platform sets out why the key to advancing a leadership vision for sustainability transformation begins and ends with leadership, and that the true test of purpose is having an authentic, impactful voice on the issues a leader is most passionate about. Chapter 13. The three stages of the model in their entirety comprise the journey to exponentiality. By the end of Part 3.0, we hope leaders will have identified new possibilities for their own sustainability leadership journey. It is in their power to execute a vision that not only shifts the direction of the company, but has the power to change an entire industry, and even, in some modest way, the world. This book is rich with cases and examples provided by respected Swedish business leaders from leading large industrial companies to startups who have generously shared their stories, opened up their toolboxes to reveal their best strategies, and shared their personal motivations for why sustainability is a main driver of their business leadership. Further insights are provided by a range of experts and thought leaders who shared their views with us. Investors, economists, next-generation innovators, and sustainability advocates. We have found it to be an inspiring journey and hope you will too. In the conclusion, No Time to Lose, we leave listeners with a call to action. Don't settle for incremental improvement. We don't have all the answers, but the urgency of rising to the challenges of a more sustainable world is greater than ever. It's time to step up and use your leadership platform to make a difference. The world is counting on us. Exponentiality Cheat Sheet. These key terms and definitions are unique to this book and represent our interpretation of these words. As you'll notice with the creative spelling, there's a Swedish flair. The Sustainability Leadership Model. An original model developed by Elaine Weidman Grunewald and Henrik Henriksson, summarizing three phases of sustainability leadership. These are the Foundation 1.0, the Core 2.0, and the Leap 3.0, which together can lead to exponential sustainability impacts. They are interdependent, and the end goal of exponential impacts cannot be achieved without the first two. Planetary lens. A way to view and understand a company's impact on the environment and the planet. Societal lens. A way to view and understand a company's impact on people, communities, and society more broadly. Society as a stakeholder. An approach that looks beyond traditional stakeholders to include society as a key stakeholder and assume responsibility for maximizing the positive impacts and minimizing the negative ones. Societal ecosystem. A business ecosystem that applies a planetary and societal lens to understand the science and impacts on people and planet while engaging with other actors and finding new value chains. Exponentiality. A company journey to achieve exponential sustainability impact that is based on purpose-driven leadership, a strong integration with your core business, and finding your X-factor level of ambition. Exponentiality formula. The roadmap that links each phase of our model together to achieve exponentiality. The X-factor. A set of leverage points. Unique tools and accelerators that enable you to amplify your ambition and achieve greater impact. There could be many others, but we've chosen to highlight societal ecosystems, unconventional partnerships, digital technologies, and your own personal influencing platform. Digital pollution. When the use of data or data-driven technologies has harmful or negative unintended consequences on people, planet, or society as a result of unattended risks or poor data management. Chapter 2. The Northern Lights Shine Bright. Ask someone to describe Sweden and you're likely to get a couple of predictable responses. Yeah, I've heard of Sweden. They make great chocolate and clocks. No, that's Switzerland, but try telling that to the New York Stock Exchange, which infamously raised the Swiss flag on the day that one of Sweden's hottest companies, Spotify, went public. Confusing Sweden with Switzerland is one thing, but a more perplexing portrayal for Swedes is having their country described as socialist. Isn't it like living behind the Iron Curtain, goes a common refrain? Swedes will take pains to outline the distinction between their social democracy and communist-style socialism. Sweden embraces capitalism pretty much as the U.S. does, albeit through its own middle way, as we'll describe shortly. Let's bust that myth of socialism here and now and instead share some facts about Sweden. When Swedish business leaders talk about what makes them tick, a number of special national qualities surface time and time again. Qualities like balance, equality, and a healthy dose of humility, an outward-facing focus and strong global market mindset, an unwavering emphasis on efficiency, functionality, and continuous improvement, and the ability to think long-term and see the big picture. Such traits help in a country the size of California, but with a fraction of its population, where people work hard through long, dark winters, keeping the faith that if they persevere, the sun will eventually shine on them during the endless Swedish summer days. In this prologue and throughout this book, we explore how Swedish companies are intrinsically connected to their heritage. The culture, the values, the particular model of social democracy, the government's prominent role as a champion of sustainability, and, not least, a national affinity for nature and respect for the environment that almost verges on religious zeal. We think there's an intriguing story to be told about what it means for a company to be born with the inherent sustainability advantages that derive from the Swedish brand, and how this can inspire global business leaders. Among the Scandinavian CEOs featured in this book, some gloss over their heritage while others are quite conscious of how it shapes their decisions and corporate purpose. Pin them down in a conversation, perhaps over that revered cultural institution of fika, the Swedish coffee break, and Swedes will eventually acknowledge there is something special about Swedish leadership that is worth exploring. Fika itself is a case in point. These twice-daily breaks in the workday occur universally, from cafes to kitchen tables to conference rooms and C-suites. But unlike the hurried water-cooler office chats that American workers might be accustomed to, these are sit-down, take-your-time sessions, a fair and equal place for an exchange of ideas. And what could be more Swedish than that? Getting to the bottom of Brand Sweden. As longtime leaders in iconic Swedish companies, we know it's impossible to separate the culture and values and heritage of Sweden from the factory floor, the offices, and the boardrooms. There may be different ingredients to Sweden's success, a combination of the right policies, geography, luck, or circumstances, but Sweden today has an enviable place among nations, judging from the many top spots it holds in international rankings across the areas of sustainability, human development, social progress, innovation, and transparency. That leadership is reflected in the corporate world, too. This is not to say that Sweden and Swedish companies are perfect or better than their peers in other countries. On the contrary, as we will show throughout this book, scandals, challenges, and dilemmas have affected Swedish companies just as much as others. No company or country has come close yet to solving climate change or the host of other global sustainable challenges we face. With its population of 10 million, Sweden is pursuing unsustainable levels of consumption like most of the developed world. While below that of many other industrialized countries, Sweden's carbon footprint remains significant, and its C-suites and boardrooms, despite notable progress, still have a long way to go in terms of gender equality and other measures of diversity. Clearly, there is a lot more to be done. It is also just as impossible for the captains of Swedish industry or any responsible corporate citizen around the world to feel self-satisfied in the face of a global climate movement that has been galvanized by a 17-year-old Swedish girl, Greta Thunberg, named Time Magazine's Person of the Year in 2019. Greta's fight began with lonely school strikes outside the House of Parliament in Stockholm in late 2018, sparking the youth protest #FridaysForFuture and eventually inspiring a global movement. On September 20, 2019, Greta led the biggest climate protest in world history, where roughly 4 million people from some 185 countries took to the streets to demand urgent and decisive action against the climate crisis. In December 2019, an estimated 500,000 people took part in a rally in Madrid to bring that same message to governments and decision makers at the COP25 climate negotiations. The world Greta and her generation will inherit is making them, along with other protests and climate movements like the Extinction Rebellion, angry and worried. Elaine recalls Greta's words at Brilliant Minds in Stockholm 2019, an elite global gathering of politicians, business leaders, entrepreneurs, and artists. I know you are not acting like this because you are stupid. I know that almost every one of you is simply uninformed, just like the rest of the world's population. We are equally tired of inaction, as are the business leaders featured in this book. While Greta and other activists are helping to fan a new spark of urgency, the foundations for corporate sustainability in Sweden and elsewhere were started long ago. We recognize that big challenges demand big-picture thinking and bold solutions. They require exponential outcomes. In the earnest nature of Swedes, they are set on figuring out a better way. In this book, we offer a smörgåsbord of themes to showcase the Swedish approach to corporate sustainability that we believe can offer some inspiration to other leaders. Small but mighty. Sweden may be relatively small compared to the much larger economies of the world, but its influence has been significant. As a small but well-respected player on the global scene, the country and its business leaders are accustomed to forming alliances to leverage change, a useful attribute when it comes to tackling complex challenges. Because Sweden's prosperity is highly dependent on exports, Swedes are generally outward-looking. The reliance on exports means Swedish companies need to be flexible and adaptable, and yet competitive enough to command a global footprint, to be relevant and survive, especially alongside much larger nations like the US, Germany, China, and Japan. The Wallenberg family is a leading Swedish business family with investments in most of the country's blue-chip companies. Jacob Wallenberg, the chair of Investor AB, the industrial holding company arm of the family, has reflected on what makes Swedish companies leaders despite the small size of their motherland. It is interesting to look at Swedish companies. Broadly speaking, we have a disproportionate number of large companies in this country. These companies have one thing in common. They are highly focused and they are world leaders. The point is that you focus on a few things and make sure that you are really, really good at those things. Then you can survive and you can become a world leader. How do you continuously develop a company? If you connect that to coming from a small country and being totally dependent on international trade, we are subject to the most severe competition you can think of as you enter the rest of the world. You have no defense other than being as good as possible. You have to focus on excellence and being a world leader. Considering that Swedes represent just 0.13% of the global population, the Nordic nation has a disproportionate amount of influence on global innovation. Sweden tops several indices when it comes to innovation. It is typically in the top 5 in Bloomberg's Innovation Index, ranking the 60 most innovative companies worldwide, 5th place in 2020. Further, Sweden is the EU's Innovation Leader 2019 according to the Innovation Union Scoreboard, an index published by the European Commission. It earned the number 2 spot among 126 economies in the 2019 Global Innovation Index from the World Intellectual Property Organization. Sweden invests more than 3% of the country's GDP in R&D, more than many other countries, particularly in the fields of sustainable technology and life sciences. In support of that creativity, entrepreneurship is enshrined in Swedish law. For the past 2 decades, full-time workers with permanent jobs have enjoyed the right to take a 6-month leave of absence to launch a company, or alternatively, to study or to look after a relative. Their employers can reject the request only if there are crucial operational reasons that they can't manage without a staff member, or if the new business is viewed as direct competition. After the leave period, employees are expected to be able to return to their previous positions. So it is perhaps no coincidence that Stockholm has earned the reputation of the startup capital of the world, particularly in ICT and tech. With global successes like Skype, Spotify, Minecraft, Candy Crush, iZettle, and Klarna, Stockholm boasts the largest number of billion-dollar startups in Europe. After Silicon Valley, the Swedish capital is the most prolific tech hub in the world on a per capita basis. In the areas of peace and security, sustainability, and human development, Sweden also punches above its weight. One of the early architects of the United Nations was Swedish diplomat Dag Hammarskjöld, who became the second Secretary General of the UN in 1953, the only Nobel Peace Prize laureate to have been awarded the distinction posthumously. Former Secretary General Kofi Annan said of Hammarskjöld that he had done more to shape public expectations of the office of Secretary General and the UN than any other person in its history. In another world first, the inaugural UN Conference on the Human Environment was held in Stockholm in 1972, and the Swedish government has been a key supporter of the UN Global Compact, the world's largest corporate sustainability initiative since it was launched in 2000. Over and above its ongoing commitment to the UN, Sweden has long been committed to doing its share, some would say even more than its share, to address poverty and development. In terms of official development assistance, ODA, Sweden is the largest donor in proportion to the size of its economy. In absolute terms, it is the sixth largest donor country, maintaining a long-term commitment to spend at least 1% of its gross national income on ODA since 2008. And in terms of contributions to science, the arts, and letters, the Nobel Prize is widely considered the world's most prestigious award and has become synonymous with Sweden's respect for scholarship, innovation, entrepreneurship, and world-changing contributions to humankind. What's in a word? That a culture which promotes innovation, entrepreneurship, diplomacy, equality, diversity, inclusion, privacy, and respect for the individual also turns out to be a fertile platform for corporate sustainability leadership should perhaps come as no surprise. It's even embedded in the language. The Swedish term for business is näringsliv, which directly translates to nurturing life. Joran Genvi is an executive strategic consultant and founder of Nature Academy Learning Lab, where relevant leadership development is held in the form of nature quests. Joran often reminds Swedes of the power of their language. One example is Hushålla med knappa resurser, literally to run your household economy on limited resources. Joran says when he mentions the term to finance managers or executives, they get it. They understand that all resources, financial, human, and natural, have to be used efficiently and in combination to create the possibility for a sustainable business and planet. One word in particular captures both an admirable and a challenging trait. Logum. The term translates to not too little, not too much, or just right. It can be variously translated as in moderation or in balance. With its emphasis on just enough, the phrase can be interpreted as embracing a middle ground in life. The Swedish proverb, lagom är bäst, literally means the right amount is best. In Sweden, people joke about a clothing size called extra medium, which is supposed to fit the entire nation. Global strategist at Omnicom Group Mark Boutros, while American-born, is a longtime observer and citizen of Sweden. For Mark, lagom is a double-edged sword. Swedes are so shy to talk about their sustainability or corporate social responsibility attributes, afraid of someone saying, "You are not doing it good enough," or "You have made this mistake," or they are reticent to talk about their accomplishments in sustainability in a way that an American competitor might talk about more aggressively. It's hard to be Lagom in a Lady Gaga world. But Lagom is a fundamental value that infuses how Swedes approach most things. A model for inclusive growth. Nothing could be more Lagom than the Swedish model. Described as a strategy for inclusive growth, Sweden's middle way with its social democracy objective is to increase prosperity for the benefit of all, while safeguarding the autonomy and independence of citizens. It consists of three fundamental pillars: a labor market that facilitates adjustment to change, a universal welfare policy, and an economic policy that promotes openness and stability. According to Jeffrey Sachs, university professor and director of the Center for Sustainable Development at Columbia University and director of the UN Sustainable Development Solutions Network, Sweden's social democratic ethos said, "We want to invent a better social model." It was a rather deliberate idea of social engineering in the right way. The goal originally was not environmental, rather it was social inclusion, social justice, and industrial peace. But that meant that Sweden began experimenting and inventing a system that nobody else had, but in a very moderate way. From the 1930s through the 1960s, the economic model alone was innovative and very normative in the sense of saying, "We're not leaving things to the market. We're trying to achieve certain objectives, a fair society, socially inclusive, developing technology, being internationally competitive." By most accounts, that model has been successful. By international comparison, Sweden is a prosperous country whose wealth is evenly distributed. A sense of a responsibility to do your share extends to the country's generous immigration policies, although these have been tested in recent years with record-breaking numbers of asylum seekers arriving in 2015. As a third way between savage capitalism and unrealistic socialism, the Swedish model could be exactly what the world needs, according to Sue Reed, principal advisor, finance at Mission 2020, a global campaign convened by global climate change leader Christina Figueres. In the U.S. and some other countries, Sweden is seen as having a government system that is not American and socialist. That's a barrier that needs to be broken through to translate Swedish sustainability leadership, which is quite real and quite impressive, to correct these misperceptions and beliefs so that Sweden's leadership gets broader traction as a role model for long-term viability, economically and otherwise. Sweden is one of the few countries that's kind of figured it out in terms of how to exert leadership on sustainability, fully taking into account the equitable equation and how people are situated in society. Together, these qualities build real resilience. Part of how Sweden has figured it out is a social welfare model that has at its core free education and healthcare for all its citizens. What Swedes may take for granted is not a given in many other countries, and it sets the foundation for success in so many other areas. For skilled employment, innovation, and entrepreneurship to sustainability and thriving communities. Because work-life balance is considered important, Swedes have among the world's most generous annual paid leave allowance at 25 days per year, and often more depending on union membership, stemming from a long history of respecting the rights of workers. Sweden also leads in its parental leave policy, the most generous in the world, with parents entitled to share 480 days, or around 16 months paid leave following the birth or adoption of a child. Some 80% of Swedes are employed, the highest employment rate in the European Union, and among all OECD countries, Sweden is near the very top when it comes to female labor force participation relative to males. Tax-financed childcare has been critical to achieving this high number of women in the workforce. Today, Sweden has closed 82.2% of its overall gender gap, according to the World Economic Forum's Gender Gap Index. It is fitting, then, that Sweden has the first feminist government in the world as a human right and a matter of democracy and justice. Sustainability at top of the agenda. Championing sustainability is something almost all Swedes will tell you is part of their DNA. Sweden has long shown leadership across the fields of environment, sustainability, and human rights. Since the mid-1990s, Sweden has been one of the few industrialized countries to achieve the absolute decoupling of economic growth and greenhouse gas, GHG, emissions. A rising economy paired with falling emission levels. Sweden's GHG emissions are among the lowest in the EU and OECD, whether calculated per capita or as a proportion of GDP. In 1995, Sweden became one of the first countries to introduce a carbon tax, and nearly all energy in Sweden is carbon-free, with 54% renewable, the highest percentage in the EU. Sweden has set a goal to become one of the first fossil-free nations, with a zero-emissions vision for 2045. It also scores well in other aspects of sustainable living, such as low air pollution, high consumption of eco-labeled foods and second-hand items, and high recycling rates. Sustainability advocate Jeffrey Sachs puts it this way. Sweden has really been the pioneer of sustainable development from the start. The Swedish model is fair, inclusive, clean, and technologically sophisticated. Sweden brings the technological approaches to these questions, and that's what we really need. We need basically to deploy technologies. I'm not a huge fan of the degrowth agenda, although it depends on how all these terms are defined and so forth. But I take growth to mean progress in quality of life and living standards, which I think can be accomplished through technological improvements and a social inclusion framework. And this is basically the social democratic approach of Sweden. The results speak for themselves. From environmental health to competitiveness, Sweden is near the top of innumerable sustainability international rankings. First place in the following. Top National Green Economy Plan among 20 nations from the Green Economy Coalition launched at the World Economic Forum 2020. The Global Sustainable Competitiveness Index 2019 for the fourth consecutive year. The world's most reputable country in 2018, which examines the 55 largest countries on ethics, perception of corruption, aesthetic beauty, and that feel-good factor. Among OECD countries in the 2019 Sustainable Development Index for its implementation of the SDGs and the RoboCoSAM Country Sustainability Ranking. 2018 and 2019. Third out of 180 countries in the Corruption Perception Index 2019. Fourth in the Good Country Index, which ranked it 4 of 162 on everything from living standards to environmental sustainability, and in the Rule of Law Index 2019. 7th of 189 countries in the Human Development Index 2018. Denmark, Norway, and Finland can also routinely be found at the top of these lists. That the Nordic countries share so many leadership traits makes perfect sense to Jeffrey Sachs. The neighborhood is friendly that way, he observes. Denmark, Norway, and Finland all have a shared perspective on this, so there's a lot of interchange and a shared framework, and we just hear a lot of good ideas coming from the Nordic region. It makes a very big difference. All of the Nordic countries are making longer-term plans. That's also a core feature of Scandinavian or Nordic politics, that the region is stable enough to have a long-term view, which is not the case for many countries. I think in Sweden you couldn't find, as far as I know, a climate-denying company, or you couldn't find a lobby that would say, slow down. Everybody wants to solve problems in a practical way. Maybe everyone's just scared of Greta, but whatever it is, we don't want to be scolded. Respect for nature. Whether it is really a fear of being scolded or rather the desire to do the right thing, Swedes by and large share a fundamental respect for the planet tied to their basic affinity for nature, something that runs deep in the Swedish soul and contained in yet a few more essential Swedish terms. More than 80% of Swedes lives within 5 kilometers of a national park, nature reserve, or other nature conservation area. The idea of friluftsliv, nature-based outdoor recreation, is a movement with its roots in the late 19th century. Sweden is also unique in its concept of allemansrätten, or universal access laws, which tosses out the concept of trespassing on private property so that anyone can enjoy the right to be anywhere in nature provided they show consideration to animals and nature. Some see this right as a symbol of what is typically Swedish and a national symbol of equality. According to executive coach Joran Jenvi, thanks partly to allemansrätten and to our traditions, we have created this platform for how we relate, act, and understand the world. Many decision makers, it could be politicians or CEOs, people of power, they spend time at their summer houses in the archipelago, or they go skiing or hiking in the mountains, they go hunting in the woods, fishing by the streams. They take time to be in nature. Figure 2.1. Whether it's expressed in their fervent support of conservation or the way they enjoy the wide open spaces and the forests that cover more than half of the country's total land area, Swedes are proud of their country's leadership in sustainability. Almost 80% of Swedish citizens believe that it is important that Sweden is a pioneer and leading country in environmental and climate work. At the same time, Swedes think deeply about the impact of their lifestyles on the environment. Research from Nordic Ecolabel show that 40% of Swedes often think about sustainability when they make choices in their everyday lives, and 2 out of 3 said they are highly worried about the climate crisis, jumping to 77% of those under the age of 29. Swedes also expect their companies to be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.